Welcome to Renaissance Radio. We are a project of Renaissance Forum, which exists to help people discern their calling and deploy their calling against the decaying culture. And tonight, we have a very special guest who has certainly discerned and is deploying his calling, in particular in the world of Hollywood. You know him as the executive producer and producer of X-Men, X-Men 2, Crouching Tiger 2, Hocus Pocus, Mighty Joe Young, the original Star Trek series, Fantastic Four, Captive, The Giver, The Promise, and much more. Please help me welcome to the studio Mr. Ralph Winter. Good to be with you, Ralph.
Thank you.
How are you feeling this morning?
I'm good. Thank you.
Got enough caffeine going in the studio, so hopefully that'll work. And we have a great show lined up for you tonight, and we're inviting you to call in to ask questions about film, faith, or anything related to Hollywood, Christianity, or culture. Let me introduce our panelists as well. I've got to my right here Dr. John Marriott. How are you doing this morning, John?
Good, Rich. Glad to be here tonight.
Share a little bit with us, the listening audience, again, a little bit about yourself.
I teach at Biola University in the philosophy department and the intercultural studies department, and I spend a lot of time thinking about the topic of deconversion, why people lose their faith, and what we can do about it to help prevent it.
Excellent. Thanks, John. And good to be with you, Jeff.
Yeah, I'm Jeff Saravanan. I'm currently a MA philosophy student at Talbot. Work in IT. Started off with a background doing music, and currently loving life right now.
Great. And another regular panelist, Sarah Renee. Hi, Sarah.
Hey, good morning. My name is Sarah, and I am a single mother. I work from home as a writer and editor for the Special Divine Action Project, which is a grant project between Western Michigan University and Oxford University, where we map the debates about special divine action in the modern era of apologetics.
Wow, that's intense. I love it. I love it. Well, we are really excited to have in studio for you a special guest. Ralph is a member of the board of Renaissance Forum. He's also just an incredible man of God. He's done incredible things throughout his life. But most importantly, he went to Cal Berkeley.
Yeah, baby. Go Bears.
That's right.
Go Bears.
Several of us in the room who are Cal alum. And again, we're going to invite you to go ahead and call in. We're going to be talking about fame. Well, maybe actually, how do you deal with fame? But faith as well, film, and Christianity and culture. The number to call in is 1-888-995-KKLA. That's 1-888-995-5552. We actually have a phone number that you can text in your questions now. And that phone number is 949-572-0995. That's 949-572-0995. We got a lot of things going on here. We got a Facebook feed. If you go to facebook.com/renforum, you'll see us live there. We've got 75 other cameras in the room. We've got Ethan, Max, Ethan Kadar, Max Kliber, and Joseph Lyons on the production team helping us out here. But do feel free to give us a call. That's 1-888-995-5552. That's 1-888-995-KKLA. So the first thing I think we can talk about here is because we really do, the Renaissance Forum exists to kind of help people find their calling. We believe that if people can find their calling, and as youngsters say, these days say, crush it in their field, then truly in their corner of the world, they'll be redeeming culture because they found what they're called to do. And we talk a lot about people being called to Christ, as it were, as disciples, but then having a calling from Christ. And that's kind of a secondary calling. And obviously, Ralph, you've journeyed through that. But before we talk about your calling as a filmmaker, maybe even a husband, father, and so forth, why don't you tell us a little bit about your actual faith journey and how you came to Christ?
It was in a camp, Green Oaks Boys Ranch, run by Salvation Army, I think, or I can't remember exactly who ran it. But I was 12. And it was my Sunday school teacher, Steve Hopkins, that led me to the Lord. And it was, you know, it was a camp experience. It was dramatic, and it was wanting to change my life and give my life to God. Mm. And it was memorable, and I remember to this day where I was sitting and praying the prayer. Throughout high school, I think it took on a different meaning and different implications. And so really as a, you know, later in high school as a senior, kind of rededicated my life that I wanted to serve. I wanted to find what that meant. And if that meant going into full-time ministry or whatever, I threw myself into you know, youth ministry and ministry in the church. I was in a Presbyterian church, and you know, very involved, and it was a rich experience. I was with a lot of other young folks that, you know, we were sold out. It was great. Mm-hmm. Had a lot of fun. Spent a lot of mission trips. Spent a summer in Mississippi with John Perkins. That was life changing, and it was a very, very, very formative. I was very fortunate to be in a place that I was getting, you know, good input, good, you know, preaching and Sunday school and Bible study and lots of good academic kind of discipline in my life, which was good.
That's interesting. You said, you know, as you were saved, you had this sense of maybe wanting to go into ministry, as it were. Doesn't William Wilberforce say they had that famous exchange? You know, here's this great reformer, parliamentarian, eventually abolished the slave trade in the British Empire. And yet, when he met John Newton, his pastor, he said, "I want to go into ministry. I found God, or rather, God found me, and now I want to serve him with my life." And John Newton, the hymn writer, Amazing Grace, he says, "Well, what does he say?" Right? He says, "You're in ministry. We need you right where you are in Parliament." Yeah. And so you decided not to go into quote unquote full time ministry. But so how do you, if anything, how do you see the integration of your faith life, as it were, and your work life, if anything? What kinds of ways does your faith impact your filmmaking, or vice versa? How does filmmaking kind of impact your faith?
Yeah, I think that transition for me happened when I got out of college and I was just holding down a job while my wife was in school. Then we were going to swap, and then I'd go back to school again to pursue some kind of teaching or ministry, and wasn't really sure. But, you know, life happens. We had kids instead. That sort of changed the dynamic, and so I necessarily had to throw myself more into my job, and that's when this process began of you're talking about, of what is my place, and what should I be doing, and where do I find a way to live this out and be a follower. And that sort of naturally came in the jobs I was doing in terms of telling stories and figuring out, and particularly the reaction I'd get from people. At first it was industrial videos for employees, but then it became, you know, the studios, you know, making product for an audience. And it's powerful how, you know, those stories resonate. And so for me, it became, you know, how can I contribute to that? How can I tell my story through this? How I've been affected and how I experienced the human journey, how is that going to be impacted in what I do on a day-to-day basis? So what it's become for me is, in making movies and being a part of the team that makes movies, I think deeply about what the story is, how that, you know, can be helpful, interesting, stimulating, questioning. And that sort of matches up with my faith as well, in terms of the journey that I'm on, is to figure out the same thing. What's this about? How does it fit in? What am I going to be when I grow up? All that stuff.
Yeah, that's right. That's right. Yeah, we met, as I remember, a couple of years ago at a dinner here down in downtown. Yeah. And that night, I don't know if you recall this, there was a mutual friend of ours who was also speaking that night, as you were. And I remember him saying something which is profound. He was an investment banker.
Yeah.
And he was saying how the goal of his faith and the goal of his investment is the same, which is to bring justice and shalom in the world.
Yeah,
I thought that was pretty profound. And you said something too in conversation that we had about. So let me just ask a question bluntly. I mean, so for example, you do a lot of incredible work, obviously making films, flying all around the world, producing incredible blockbusters, and you carry your faith in many ways on your sleeve. Let me ask you this question: what do you see as the role of witnessing, right? I say that because some people say, well, look, I'm an engineer, and the way I do my Christianity at work is I just kind of do my job, but then when I have that four-minute water cooler conversation, I'm going to make sure I share the gospel. And that's kind of how they do faith work integration, as it were. And I don't know that that's the most nuanced or the most, you know, integrated way of doing it.
No, that's not my... I don't feel called in that way. You know, I think primarily in the job that I do as a leader, a producer, Part of my job is managing a project and helping the studio or financier get it to the finish line. Mm. And a big part of that is how people are treated. And so for me, I go out of my way to be sure that the way people are treated fairly, they are treated with respect, with justice, that I expect to, even when I fire somebody, that I want to do it in a respectful way. And if I'm really good at it, they'll say thank you. Mm-hmm. That people deserve that. And it may be hard to understand, but I don't think most people think of Christians acting that way. Mm. So I want to act that way. Mm. I don't want to proselytize. There's plenty of opportunity after work or outside of the workplace for those conversations, and they happen. Mm-hmm. People come to me and say, how do you survive? Mm-hmm. How do you do this? Mm-hmm. Why, you know, how do I get through this? Mm-hmm. And I've never had anybody say, you know, when I say, can I pray for you, they don't say no. Mm-hmm. But I feel like as a boss, I can't do that in the work environment because that's just wrong. Mm-hmm. It's wrong for people to even have the hint that, you know, they might do better or get a promotion or earn sure. more money if mm-hmm. somehow, mm-hmm. gee, I can, if I'm just a good Christian for Ralph.
Yes.
That's wrong.
Or if I listen to his gospel presentation, maybe, and that sort of undue pressure.
Yeah, mm-hmm. you
yeah.
can't do it.
Yeah. I remember.
So I'm very careful about that. Mm. Very careful about, you know, because also I think as leaders, and I'm sure this is true in a lot of businesses, it's not just the movie business, mm-hmm. but everybody's watching. Mm. Everybody's paying attention and they're observing who you are, what you say, how you treat people. Even though you're not the object, they're watching how you do that. And on the set, with 150 people on set, everybody knows. Mm-hmm. They all know.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, we talk here a lot about the visual gospel and the verbal gospel. Mm. And the verbal gospel, we all know, obviously, it's the gospel message. But the visual gospel is painting that background or living out the gospel so people can recognize it and say, well, that's really good, true, or beautiful. And then when they actually hear the verbal gospel, they're like, this feels familiar. Mm-hmm. Like I saw it in this guy, Ralph, right? Yeah. So yeah, I remember one time you said, you know, all the stuff that you do is, you said, I witness, I think we were joking tongue-in-cheek, but you were like, I witness all the time on the set. And then sometimes I go out to afterward for coffee and I actually share the gospel with them. Yeah. But you bringing it under budget, on time, is your witnessing on the set all the time.
Well, that's, you know, if that's for the studio and the employer, mm-hmm. you know, it's not my money, mm-hmm. it's theirs. And so, you know, part of what I'm charged with is to manage that properly. Mm-hmm. Now, I think you also fight for the movie. That's what they hire you for. And so if there's a reason to spend more or go over, you know, you can articulate that with the financier. But, yeah, that's part of it.
Yeah.
You know, but to be clear, my wife and I do not look at each other and say, let's go see that movie that came in on budget.
Mm. No, right.
No one cares. You know, the movie's got to be good.
Yes.
And so that's really the yes. arbiter and marker and criteria.
Yeah.
Mm. And so in some ways, to be a good producer, you got to fight for the movie.
Yeah, that's right. Bring it to excellence. I want you to share a little story about Hugh Jackman that you were talking about earlier with us, if you will, but in a moment. But I just want to throw out the numbers again. It's 1-888-995-KKLA. That's 1-888-995-5552. You can text in questions at 949-572-0995. Again, we're on Facebook Live right now. You can get a chance to see what's going on in the studio. You can see Sarah Renee, Dr. John Marriott, Jeff Sirabandon, and of course, producer, special guest, Ralph Winter. Facebook.com/RenForum. Give us your thoughts. So you talked a lot about just how to treat people. And I want our panelists to jump in and feel free to get some questions here. But the question I have is, you know, you told the story about Hugh Jackman. I thought it was powerful because he is a believer, isn't he?
His parents know, are people of faith, and he's certainly surrounded by people of faith, and he's certainly active and friendly at Hillsong and lots of different churches that are, lives in New York and his friends back in Australia. Mm-hmm. But Hugh's a gentleman, and Hugh is one of the finer examples of human beings in the business. Mm. And It was always remarkable. We did Wolverine Origins in Sydney because he wanted to shoot in his own country. And we did that movie. And every day, there's a number of people that came from outside of Australia to work on the picture as well. But every Friday, he bought a lottery ticket for every member of the crew.
Mm.
And he went around to each crew member, called them by name, handed them a ticket, and said, good luck, mate. And nobody really won a lot of money, but everyone looked forward to Friday when Hugh would come around and just look you in the eye, shake your hand, hand you a ticket, and say, thanks for working hard.
Mm.
And that's classy. That's unusual. There are a lot of other people like that in the movie business, but I experienced that with Hugh. And, you know, you don't forget that stuff.
Yeah.
And I think the whether you were the producer or whether you were a PA, he treated you the same.
Mm.
And it was a wonderful example for everyone.
And it's kind of neat, actually. Maybe it makes sense that in the sense of the mission of Renaissance Form, cultivating truth, goodness, and beauty, wherever those things may be found, maybe it's good that he's not a Christian in that sense, because it reminds me of Renee Zellweger when she was on the red carpet, right? A reporter came up to her, because she was wearing a very wholesome dress that night at the Oscars, and they said, Renee, what's with the wholesomeness, right? And she just, without skipping a beat, looks back at the reporter and says, well, I thought Hollywood could use some wholesomeness, and then walks away. I don't know. Again, I don't know her faith background. She probably isn't a Christian. But the fact that she gave 15-year-olds an alternative vision of beauty is what it's all about.
Yeah.
I mean, we can, again, going back to Wilberforce, we can partner with men and women of goodwill who just want to abolish the slave trade. And today's slave trade needs to be abolished by just people of goodwill.
Yeah.
And so Hugh Jackman, all the power to him. All the more to him. Yeah. So again, the number to call in. You have a chance to talk to Ralph Winter, the producer of X-Men, Crouching Two, Hocus Pocus, Mighty Joe Young, all these great films that we all know. He is the producer on all these shows, and the number is 1-888-995-5552. 1-888-995-5552. I'm gonna give my panelists a chance to just barrage you with some questions now, Ralph.
So, Ralph, when you pick up a script or when you're looking to do a movie, what are some of the things that you look at? What are some of the criteria or the qualities that you look for, in a script, just from a good quality movie perspective? And then how would you also bring your faith into that in evaluating what kind of movie you'd like to produce?
So the kinds of movies, you know, there's a variety of things in making a choice. You know, first of all, it's got to be a pretty good script, or the story is just not interesting. That's most of the projects I've turned down, if that's the reason. Story is just, you know, not interesting to me. It also plays out, you know, who's directing, you know, who's financing, who's going to distribute the movie, you know, what are all those pieces that are there to see if it makes sense and is worthwhile. Now, all those don't have to be in place. You just got to know that you're in for a longer journey. It's going to be harder to do. And certainly projects that I've generated from my own stuff, you know, take the longest amount of time because you're trying to get all those pieces in place. I don't know that I try to work my faith into my movies. That's not my objective. I'm trying to find a good story where I can be helpful, be a part of the team, and participate and maybe shape the movie in terms of how it's told as a great story. But I'm not looking for places to turn a character into a Christian or have someone say the sinner's prayer. If anything, I'm trying to find a way to get to the widest audience, but with authentic human, you know, experiences that I believe, as God has created us, that in itself is going to be pointers to the gospel.
Do you feel any sense of expectation or pressure from the Christian community that to try and do those things, to try and work that in? Otherwise, they may feel like you're not doing what God has called you to do, and because He's placed you in such a, you know, a role.
I don't feel that pressure because I don't listen to that group. I don't really care. In the past, I've gotten criticism, like working on a movie like Hocus Pocus, because people came to me and said, you know, how can you as a Christian work in a movie that has witches in it? And my and this was done publicly.
Hmm.
And
wow.
I retorted that, A, did you see the movie, which they had not, and B, that the point of the story, the climax of the story, is the boy who offers and sacrifices his life for his sister. And what does that remind you of? And the witches also get their comeuppance. They're destroyed at the end of the picture.
Mm.
And I think also just the very presence of being a part of the creative team, that there was stuff that didn't get into the movie because I was there and able to shoot some of those things down because it wasn't good storytelling. Not necessarily because the Bible says it shouldn't be in the movie, but rather that it was bad storytelling. And I think, so for me, the lesson that I learned from that is that, you know, the better the storyteller I am, the better I can engage as part of the team on a pure storytelling level that also serves to tell an authentic story. I did have some resistance from my church, you know, after being in the movie business for a while, and there were all well-meaning folks that, you know, did you get over that Hollywood thing? Are you done? Are you going to get a real job? Are you going to go into ministry? Are you going to do stuff and stuff we've seen you as a kid growing up to do? And that was hard to sort of, you know, go back to them and say, I feel like this is the right thing to do. This is where I belong.
Mm-hmm.
So that was difficult with some older, again, very well-meaning members of the church community that I was a part of. But I don't feel that anymore. I don't see that. I see a little of it when I'm, you know, traveling and speaking in other parts of the country. But only when I'm speaking in the U.S.
You said this is, you said at one point, you said, this is me, and this is, I found out this is what I'm made for. Mm. We talk a lot about, it's kind of corny, but I think it's kind of cool. GPS, gifts and passions, serving God's purposes. Gifts are deeper than skills because gifts are inborn. Skills are developed, like musical gifting. You can learn to play the scales as a skill, but you have to have the musical gift. Then the passions are, in the Greek, what you're willing to suffer for. Mm-hmm. So those are much deeper than interests. Interests come and go, but passions, I'm going to med school, I'm going to go into medical mission, whatever, medical doctor, and I'm willing to suffer med school. You're not willing, you're interested in ice cream, but you're not willing, right? So there's a difference. So gifts and like, how did you come to discern your gifts and passions? Because we take a lot of calls from folks typically on a Friday night saying, you know what, I'm trying to discern my calling, can you help? How did you come to discern your purpose, your why, your gifts, your passions?
It took a while, and part of it was, again, I stayed with the movie stuff because it was a job and I had to, because we started a family and it wasn't the grand plan that we had laid out as a couple. But that's it. That's life, and that's fine. And so it took a while before neither of us were really sure that the job would last. You know, do people really want to see Star Trek movies? Will there be another one? Really?
Mm.
You know, it was like, I don't know.
Mm-hmm.
And when that finally stuck, when we did the fourth one, it felt like it was successful and I could see a career, I could see a way of doing this. And then it began to stick and see that this was something that you could actually figure out, you know, how to make a living at.
Mm.
And I've been very fortunate to work, and, you know, that's, you know, God's grace that I've been able to work. It's not because I've lined up all these things and made these things. I didn't make any of this happen.
Mm.
I'm a history major from Berkeley.
Yeah, yeah.
I don't live in Hollywood. I don't have any friends or family, you know, originally to help me in Hollywood. So I feel like that's a gift. And so I feel a responsibility to use that gift wisely. And that I've learned, I've you know, had to figure that stuff out along the way.
Mm.
Do you feel that your faith provides you with creative resources that may be unique to someone that maybe if they didn't have share the same faith, that maybe just there's some resources that are available to Christians that can be used for, you know, filmmaking, but just, you know, art in general? because sometimes it feels like, unfortunately, sometimes Christian art feels like it's subpar. And so I'm just curious, do you kind of, you know, are you able to tap into that? Or I'm just curious your thoughts on that.
It's funny, you know, I think actually, this may sound weird, but actually some of the times I feel most creative is during a sermon. And it's not because I'm not listening to the sermon, I am. I'm taking notes, I'm listening. But my mind races during a sermon about other creative thoughts, about what I'm doing, about what I'm working on, or about other projects that I want to develop. It's odd. But I feel sometimes my most creative when I'm in church, in that worship experience, that I'm hearing, processing things a little differently inside of a worship service. I don't know that I feel I've got any special leverage creatively, because I don't feel that. But there is, I think, in a devotional time, in a worship setting, I feel, I don't know that I can put my finger on exactly what's happening, but I feel that creative stuff.
So, Ralph, on the other side of the break, I'm going to ask you this question about, you were filming Hackers, and then you got an invitation to do James Bond. It's a little story about putting, you know, family first, the choice you had to make there. So let me throw out the numbers again. It's 1-888-995-5552. You're listening to Renaissance Radio. We'll be back on the other side of the break. Go, Joseph.
Don't say the youngsters now say.
What should I say? The hipsters now say?
Just
the millennials.
just don't.
Yeah.
The youngins.
Yeah.
What else?
That was actually it.
Okay.
I think everyone's doing well on time. Good. I think because he is the focus, it's okay for him to go a little longer.
Of course, yeah.
So that's fine.
Yeah, we discussed that earlier.
And then, yeah.
But I want you guys to feel, just jump in.
Yeah. Well, I'm just like waiting for like a segue, because I have questions about like everything.
Yeah.
But just go for it, because the point of the show is this kind of like rush at.
Like, I could talk about Hugh Jackman for 2 hours.
Go. So.
Did you want me to go audio on us?
On what?
On the, when you had the 5 minute warning, just go audio.
Just say 5 minutes.
Yeah. Just,
okay.
Yeah, thanks.
No problem.
Thanks, Zach.
No problem.
No, I have a couple things about like, because you were talking about how you don't feel as a Christian you have any special creative influence, but I know I kind of disagree a little bit. And
cool.
I could, okay.
Just jump on.
Just like Hero's Journey.
Over here somewhere.
Just
show one of
my. Because like I, same thing like Hocus Pocus.
Sure. Yeah. Hey. Thanks for people. Really appreciate you tuning in here. We've got Ralph Winter in the studio. We have a wonderful show on faith and film. And so if you have any questions, give us a call. I think the number's on the screen. And shout out to Harry Edwards for helping us out with the Facebook Live. this is a once-in-a-long-time chance to engage with a real Hollywood producer who's produced blockbusters, film all over the place, just making sure that we're not going back on live here on the radio. But we appreciate you connecting with us. You can ask a question on the screen here, or just go to the Facebook page and just type in a question. Joseph Lyons will take up those questions for you. We'd love to have a conversation on finding your calling. What does it mean for a producer to find his calling? How do you do faith and culture? So ask any question you like, and Ralph is such a kind gentleman. He'll take any of your questions. So give us a call, 1-888-995-5552.
And an eyebrow.
Right.
And it's the same.
I'm going to cut. This is nothing else to say. Actually, this question for you. What did you want?
If you're Jeff, John, if your friends want to come in then during the next break and just kind of chat with Ralph, it's a longer break.
Oh my gosh, it's a pretzels. Sorry, pardon my rage.
Not allowed.
And welcome back. You're listening to Renaissance Radio. I'm your host, Rich Park. And we have a very special guest in the studio this morning. His name is Ralph Winter, producer of X-Men, Crouching Tiger 2, X-Men 2, Hocus Pocus, Mighty Joe Young. The list goes on and on and on. He's got incredible movies. He's got TV series that he's done, worked with all the top people. You can name them in Hollywood. And he's also happens to be a very devout evangelical, doing incredible work in the world of film. Let me give you the number to call in to engage with Ralph Winter or any of us here in the panel. It's 1-888-995-5552. Again, 1-888-995-5552. You can text in 949-572-0995. Again, 949-572-0995. Maybe Joseph can put that up on the Facebook page so you can just text into that number or just leave a comment on our Facebook page, which is facebook.com/renform. How many ways are there not to get in touch with us? Jeez, there's like 85 different media now, and we've got is that a question?
Yep.
Okay, why don't we go ahead and start with a question, then we're gonna move back to this the James Bond Spielberg spiel.
Okay, so this is from John on our Facebook page. What is your general feeling, opinion about the quality of today's faith-based films? Do you think there's a place for them in Hollywood?
I think there's probably a place for them, you know, in the marketplace. They're filling a need. They're, you know, what PureFlix does, what the Kendricks brothers do at Sherwood Baptist. You know, they're good movies. They're good for the audience that wants to see them. I don't find them as competitors for what I do. And so there's people that want to see those movies, and they fill a need. So I think that's good. And by the way, I think those movies are getting better, and they're telling their stories in a better way. But in general, outside of some of the bigger players, some of those movies are just not very good, and so I don't think they attract a wider audience.
The thing that's interesting is that you were in an interview, and someone asked you this question, and you said, well, I think the difference is that they start with a message and develop a story around it, as opposed to having a great story and the message just coming through naturally. And I think that's a great way of looking at it. I think, you know, if you go in, like you're saying, with an agenda, that's going to be very clear to your audience, and it's not going to be entertaining because they're going to feel like they're being preached at. And so I thought that was a really great way of looking at that.
Sometimes that audience wants that agenda. I mean,
right.
I know some of the filmmakers. A lot of these guys, men and women, are my friends. But I feel like some of them do that purposely because that's what that audience wants, and they want something that is a bit more agenda-driven and right to the point and more propositional, as opposed to being story-based. Mm-hmm. Which is kind of what I'm after. So again, I don't see that as competition. I see that as a different market, and they're doing well and making money and allowing them to make more movies.
So Ralph, tell us, you tell us sometimes a story about when you're making the movie Hackers, which is a great film, by the way. That's the one with Redford, right?
No.
Oh, I'm thinking of...
No, this is Angelina Jolie and Johnny Lee Miller.
Oh, okay.
This
okay.
is Ian Softly directed. It's about, you know... it's about hackers.
What am I thinking of? The older one,
Sneakers.
Where Sneakers? There you go.
That one didn't make that one.
Yeah,
that was Redford.
Yeah, that's right. Okay,
that's
okay.
Right. Similar topic.
Yeah, it is. But you're making Hackers, and you got this call. Obviously, you tell a bit sort of an idea about a James Bond film, and you had to make a choice between possibly taking that call versus kind of committing to family. And anyway. What? Tell us about this.
Yeah, I took over a movie, Hackers, in London, and had a good experience making the movie. And so near the end of the movie, the head of the studio, John Calley, came to me and said, "I need you to leave the project. And it's not because you've done something wrong. It's because I like what you've been doing, and I'd love for you to come to help on GoldenEye, the James Bond movie, and." You know, would you come do that? And I said, wisely, I need to talk to my wife. I need to check with the boss. And what he didn't know is that we had been through a very painful period just a month or two before, where her father had committed suicide. Very painful, and I was out of town. And I was fortunate to have a Christian community around that helped take care of her and me, and minister to my family. I flew my wife to New York, and I flew back from London. And, you know, we had a conversation that only you can have with a spouse, that I was free to make any choice that I wanted to, but certain choices might have me living at a different address when I came back. And it was a hard but unifying weekend, and I committed right there that when this my responsibilities were done on Hackers, that I would come home and I'd stay home while my kids were still in high school, because it's just too hard to manage a family at a distance. And so that was the commitment. And I went back to John Calley in London, and I said, I can't do the job. And he said, it's too hard. And I said, no, I didn't say that. I can't do it because of my family. I can't do it because I'm, you know, as attractive as it would be to the Star Trek resume to have James Bond and be on three continents and a tank chase and St. Petersburg and blah, blah, blah. Right. I'm making a choice, and I, you know, reluctantly, I wish I could help. I got to say no. Finished the movie, and then went through a really tough period, because I felt like we had made this decision, my wife and I, that we're going to do the right thing for the family. We're going to do the right thing for, you know, the faith journey and our relationship. And so, you know, I'm praying for all the sort of significant projects that would come along, and my wife is praying for all the projects that shoot in our neighborhood. And it was a tough period. It was 6 months without work and wondering and questioning whether or not this was the right thing.
Yeah.
And out of the blue, without warning, without anything on my part, I was offered a job to work on a TV series in the San Fernando Valley near where I live. And, you know, so that was at least some work, which was good. The kicker was that the series was with Steven Spielberg.
Yeah.
It was a cop series, and I got to interact for 2 years with Steven Spielberg every day.
Gosh.
And I went on to prep a movie for him that didn't get made, but got a chance to work with him. And I'm not sure that God answers every prayer that way, but for me, it came that way, and it was, you know, it tested, and we came through that fire, and so that's always for us a marker of, you know, that we can get through almost anything.
Yeah,
and it took a lot, and my wife going through the suicide of her father at the same time, just, you know, you can just imagine the number of levels of conflict that are happening and all of that. It was a tough time.
Yeah.
But God saw us through that.
Yeah. That's amazing to me, because you sort of speak. So Steve, I don't know if you kind of caught this on video, but Steve Harvey was he was on Family Feud, and it had ended, and his mic was still hot, and he didn't know. He was just kind of chatting to some people who had left, who had remained behind, and he was just kind of speaking from his heart about, oh, you guys see me up here doing Family Feud and so on and so forth, but one, it's a whole lot of work that it took to get here. But then he goes, also at some point the road to kind of making a real impact in culture, you know, making it great or whatever, you just have to jump. At some point you just have to jump, and it, in a sense, you jumped, in a sense, from a real soft landing to a very predictable, you know, schedule and the Bond movie and build that resume, to a place of uncertainty, as you said, for 6 months. Do you have just any general piece of, like, advice or some principles you go by? Because for a lot of people, whether they're 25 or 65, 45, it's hard to make that jump. You know, I read this statistics from Barna. They said 48% of Christian millennials say they know that God is calling them to a different line of work, but they know it. they know it, but they won't make that jump. And a lot of it's financial fear, there's other things too. But do you have any just general piece of advice for people who are trying to discern, like, well, gosh, I do feel like this is where I'm supposed to go, but gosh, how do I make that passionate thing practical? Do you have any thoughts on that?
Look, I think some of that is you have to jump, and some of it, you know, maybe you put limits on it. You know, about 10 years ago, a business partner and I decided that, you know, we were going to go out and raise $100 million to make the movies we want to make, movies that were somewhat faith-affirming and that were, you know, not explicitly family and faith, but sure, stuff that would be good in the marketplace. And with the X-Men credits and everything else, mm-hmm, we thought we would do well. Mm. And so we jumped in. Mm-hmm. We jumped in completely. Mm. And we took out a 5-year lease on a business, and we failed.
Wow.
We were putting out several $100,000 a piece every year, drained all the accounts down to zero over a 5-year period, really sought God's wisdom and all of that. Mm. And we really didn't think we'd get to the end of 5 years and there'd be nothing. But that's what happened. Mm. But it was a very expensive MBA education. And I'm a lot smarter, but I'll probably have to work a little longer just to sort of make that up. But I'm proud of that experience. Mm. I think that, again, kind of went through the fire. I'm not homeless yet, but I learned some stuff. Mm. I learned of what it takes, and I learned, you know, it's sort of like that line that Richard Gere has in Officer and a Gentleman when he's browbeat by the sergeant to say, you know, why don't you just quit? And he says, I got nowhere else to go. Mm. And I think you have to get to that place where you give it all up for you to understand how it feels and see if that's, you know, what God has for you. And it wasn't, and it's okay. I went there. And it's okay.
Mm. Wow, that's real. That's very real.
Yeah.
Mm. Well, I'm going to give our audience a chance to call in again here. It's 1-888-995-5552. We're on live here on facebook.com/renform and at 99.5 FM. We're in studio with Ralph Winter, producer of many, many movies that you all have either seen or have read about or have seen advertised. And on that whole note about, you know, working, I mean, I think Rob has a question to chime in on. So feel free to jump in here, Rob. But again, the number to call in is 1-888-995-5552, 1-888-995-KKLA. So Rob Lee, my buddy. So we had a good time earlier, had a little bit of dinner with Ralph and Rob, but Rob, you got you want to tell us a little bit about your background and then jump in here?
Sure. Yeah. I write, act, getting into producing, and graduated Cal. Go Bears.
Go Bears.
Yeah. So, yeah, we're here with the crew. Ralph, when you kind of made a joke about you know, your wife praying for work in the neighborhood, but when you said you prayed for significant work, that made me wonder, what are your prayers like when it comes to work? Do you go to Solomon's Prayer where you're praying for guidance and wisdom, or do you get specific in terms of the projects you pray to come your way, or what does that look like?
Yeah, I think it's all the above, as well as praying for the people that I work with and people that I don't care for as much, because I kind of need to do that for my own sanity. I have to do that. It's not so much about the project, but more about the people and more about the wisdom and guidance and, you know, mercy that I'm not going to screw up and I'm going to treat people. I mean, I really, that's really a big concern of mine, is that, you know, how I'm going to end up, you know, treating people. And sometimes that involves fights with the studio or the other creatives in terms of, you know, what you're paying people and how you're doing it, and why did you let that guy take off? How could you do that? That's our money, you know. So it's a fight. It's a fight sometimes. So, yeah, that needs wisdom, and I pray for that.
You know, I think earlier on the show, I actually misspoke. I was saying faith and film, and then I said fame. But actually, I do wonder this a little bit. It's coming to my mind as we speak. But, you know, that you do, I mean, just look at the room. The two studios are filled with people here. Usually just me and the microphone. No, just kidding. We have a panelist usually here. But you know, you obviously get a lot of that, you know, both literally in the public press, but also in other circles and in other contexts. I mean, and yet, I find you, Ralph, just very personally speaking, one of the most down-to-earth, I mean, it's just so interesting how, you know, the producer of X-Men is like just this ordinary guy who just, you know, is trying to do life well. So how do you...
It's all fragile, man. And it's not something that I designed or I did. And it can all go away tomorrow. Mm. I could be working on my last project. Mm. That's okay. It's been a good run. I don't want it to end, mm-hmm. but... it's fragile, and it's a youth obsessed business, and I'm not a youth. it's a business that, you know, there's a cold, hard, brutal scorecard every Monday morning, mm-hmm. and if you don't match up, you're out. And it's trite, but you're sort of only as good as your last movie. It doesn't matter that you did X-Men, you know. How did The Giver perform? How did Crouching Tiger perform? Mm. And even though it's not your job to make the movie successful, you wear some of that. Mm-hmm. So, it's not mine.
Yeah,
I'm doing a job. I'm fulfilling a role, and trying to honor that along the way. Mm-hmm.
I actually want to come back to that where you said it wasn't me, it just kind of happened, and I want to come back to that in a second. But I want to take this call here from Sylvia from Los Angeles. Hey, Sylvia, you're on the air with Renaissance Radio and Ralph Winter.
That's I think as much a marketing question as anything in terms of how those movies are publicized. There's also an element, good or bad, that the Christian audience tends to be a little more cautious and wait a little bit. So, you know, a lot of Christians didn't get to see the Passion of the Christ in the movie theaters because they waited, and by the time they got around, you know, to figuring out when it was showing, it had already left the theaters. So Christians tend to be a bit more cautious in that. I think maybe one thing that Christians that are passionate about this can do is you go out to the first weekend. The first weekend box office does make a big difference. So I think that worked on The Shack. I think that got out and launched that very nicely. Case for Christ opens this weekend, so we'll see how that does. That first weekend box office is important for Christians to support. Maybe they don't all understand that, how much impact that has.
Uh,
Thank you.
Thank you, Sylvia.
One thing I want to piggyback on that, do you think it has a lot to do with the fact that the church isn't very good at supporting the arts and kind of that industry and film and just that they don't make it like a priority, I guess, to encourage people in the arts or to be part of culture in that way?
Yeah, that's a much deeper conversation, I think, because that goes so deep in terms of particularly Protestant Christianity that doesn't value the arts.
Right.
And Catholic, you know, let's name all the great Protestant directors and movies. go ahead, you can start.
Ralph Winch.
Oh, no,
producer.
Directors.
Director, none.
You know, but it's Catholics. It's, you know, it's Scorsese. Mm-hmm. It's John Ford. Mm-hmm. It's Mel Gibson. Because they're steeped in all the things about story. My wife and I had a chance to go to Italy, and we sit in the various churches, and you see the frescoes on the wall. Those are the 14th century graphic novels for kids.
That's right.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Be a 14-year-old and sit in that pew and look at guys stabbing each other and fighting and doing all that stuff. Far more interesting than listening to the mass in Latin. The Catholic Church has done such a great job of telling the gospel story in pictures and in words. And so they're much more comfortable with all of that. We've just not valued it, and it shows in the few movies I've gone around to try to raise money with. We did a movie that came out a couple years ago called Captive, which is the definitive. Rick Warren has said it's the definitive story of a changed life from reading The Purpose-Driven Life.
Right.
We never had. We got zero Christians who would put money up for that, God. And the guy who put money up for it is a billionaire out of Mexico who makes horror movies. Wrote the check.
Saw the return on it.
Wrote the check in 5 minutes. Mm-hmm. $4 million. Wow. Because he believed in David Oyelowo, he believed in the idea, and he believed in the possibilities of what it would do.
So why do you think that is? Why do you think evangelicals tend to have such a dim view on art and beauty?
Because only two came back and said that we could fight the giants. 10 said we couldn't. I think that conservatives and Protestants don't understand the media business. They're, you know, afraid, and they won't invest in it. The only guy that's in it is Phil Anschutz at Walden. Mm-hmm. He's the only one. Mm-hmm. No other conservatives or Christians are investing in the arts. And so stop complaining. Mm-hmm. Stop complaining. That's no right. one's putting their money there.
Yeah, yeah. What can we do? Like, and I'm trying to figure this out by the end of tonight.
That's awesome.
We got a question in from a text as well. So, Joseph, you can read that out for us.
Yes, this is from Kevin, an aspiring music artist. For Ralph, what are the defining factors that an entertainment passion is not the right direction to go in as a career?
Well, I think part of what you want to do is test that. You want to test your abilities. You want to see if anybody else stands up and salutes. You want to see if anybody else is recognizing your talent. And you should be going after that in a variety of ways and see if you can't build some momentum. And I think if that doesn't happen, you know, maybe there's a message there, but maybe there's a related piece you can do. Maybe it means you're not the lead composer, but maybe there's a way for you to be a musician that's helpful or be a skilled, you know, a lyricist or a skilled choreographer or a skilled, you know, in some other area in music that you're still passionate about but doesn't, may not be the perfect thing. Mm. You need to explore all that, but you got to be doing it. You got to be doing it to explore it.
Mm-hmm. I know, Max, you had a question along those lines because you were tweeting with some folks, Scott Derrickson and whatnot, and that whole difference between, like, hey, you ought to just do it because if you want to be a filmmaker, you better start doing filmmaking things, and then others giving you advice and saying, well, you might not be directing a film by next week, so you ought to just be great at holding the boom mic or whatever. And so we were talking about that earlier.
So me and Ralph were actually talking a little bit about it.
Earlier, were you?
Yeah, on the way up.
Yeah.
And he could even expand on it a little bit, but yeah, it was an article that Ralph Warner retweeted by Phil Cook saying, you know, if you wanted to go out and do something, like, go out and actually go do it. And he made examples to, like, novelists and filmmakers. He's like, start breathing like one, start thinking like one, start sleeping like one. Mm-hmm. And so my question to Ralph was, you know, where is, like, that line between, like, passion and calling and, like, thinking like one? And I know we talked about it earlier, too, on one of the shows of, like, you know, mentors coming into the lives and saying, like, you can't do that. That's not something that actually you can be doing. And, like, that's rewarding in itself, too, because we do need people in our lives to say, stop, like, this isn't for you. Even if you took the advice of a Phil Cook and said, like, no, I'm going to go out and do this and do that, and I'm going to think like this. So my question is, like, I guess my question is more of, like, for a mentor, like, kind of expanding on that. Like, when do you tell someone, like, no?
That's right, yeah. And that's a huge question, which I think on the third segment here, we want to get into mentorship. And kind of that's what we first started talking about a couple of years ago. Tony from Burbank, hang on the line. We're going to be back on the other side of the break with Renaissance Radio and producer Ralph Winter.
And I was kind of
long. No, you're good. You're good, man. You're great. This is a little bit longer break, so. And guys, if you want to ask your friends to come on in too and, you know, ask a question or two,
what have you. I just want to tell you, when you get to the segment on storytelling, I have stuff.
Cool.
I had another question.
And Gerard, really just bring it in. Honestly. Yeah.
I had another question. I was trying to bridge it, but I knew we were running on time. About mentorship, I was going to talk about when John said.
Let's do this. We're going to do the call, and then we'll do the mentorship stuff, and then we'll go on storytelling.
Park.
Do you need to use restroom or anything?
I want.
We have a lot of Facebook questions.
Oh, do you? Okay.
Yeah, I'll wait for, I mean.
Okay. What's one or two of them, so I can get a theme on them?
Is faith a theme?
Hey, Ralph, there's a couple friends that want to meet. There's Michael Tang, Jeff.
John? Yeah. Hi, how are you?
Is faith a theme?
And
then the other one is when he was getting into production, was there a period where he thought he was going to get out? And how do you handle that?
Okay, good. Let's go with that one. I'll go with Tony here.
She said she can bring in the theme.
No.
So
as a matter of fact,
is faith a theme? I feel like he kind of already went over that.
I'll like brush over it.
Okay. That way I can't just message it back.
Get the call. Yeah. Start on mentorship.
Let's do this. I'll go with this. Let him answer, and then depending on how he answers, you determine which one is more content related to that, and then we'll go with that.
Cool.
Yeah. Also, I want to say it's going to end very soon, and just tune in on
Media
or KZLA.
Hey, for those of you guys who have been listening on Facebook Live, we really appreciate you and your engagement. We also appreciate Harry for organizing all this, Harry Edwards on our team. We will be closing down Facebook Live shortly. Joseph may pick up back on Facebook Live a little bit, but at this point, probably good to just tune in at kkla.com. You'll just see a live stream right there in the top right corner, kkla.com. We really appreciate you engaging. We're going to be doing a lot more Facebook Live in the future, so thank you again for connecting with us, partnering with us, and give us a call. Take care.
Regardless, everybody's got the same
humongous
grammar, 160 hours in a movie.